Fauci, author, co-author of Vrimmel, and I think really, you know, needs no introduction. He was obviously the keynote speaker this morning. So once all our gear warms up, Mark.
Brief disclaimer, please set your bullshit detectors on stun. I'm about to start preaching. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to be talking about the real world and the boundary between the real world and the virtual world. What we see up on the screen, what we see on half of the screen, can we? Is that being blocked by something or is it just not coming through? I don't know what's going on there. Well, what you saw on half of the screen just a moment ago was the alpha of the VRML 2.0 version of something that I call Web Earth. Web Earth is a three-dimensional model of the planet Earth as it is right now from space. It uses live satellite data that's gathered in Switzerland from a machine in Minnesota, from a machine by NASA, and after it's passed through all those machines, it's actually in a format where my own meager knowledge of mathematics is capable of making an image of it. I did this work originally in... Is there a problem?
No.
Maybe that's what it was.
Do you know Tom Van Sant?
Yes. And Tom Van Sant wants to own the world. So, I crawled it. There we go. That's starting to come through. And the first person who notices the bug in this gets a prize. I crawled into a hole at the end of March and spent a week coding because I had the data sets that I needed, and by the end of the week I'd had the model working. And it was a very intense week for me because I was actually learning some features about texture mapping that I wasn't too clear on before. And by the end of this week I had the model up and running and it was being delivered live off of a website. All right, hold that thought. I think we have a winner. And it was probably Friday night, very, very late, and I brought the model up and it looked like it was working and I broke down in tears. Not for the beauty of my own handiwork, which is actually not that excellent, but because I was beholding the body of the planet, and there's something about that image which is alluring, which is attractive to all of us. It exerts some force that I was not expecting. Now, this is an excellent example. Goes down every once in a while. I don't know if someone wants to sit there and hit the space bar every once in a while. It's an excellent example of what I was talking about in my keynote. This is a panopticon. This is a point of view that allows you to see the whole. And this image is relatively live. It's live down to about 60 minutes. That's only going to get better, folks. And while the resolution of this map is relatively limited right now, that's only going to get better. I'm starting to work with a data set for this version, which is no longer 300 by 600 as this is, but is 20,000 by 40,000. That means we're resolving features on Earth's surface down to the single kilometer. And as it gets more integrated with satellite data, I think you'll be able to resolve features down to the individual level. It will be possible to track a person probably within 10 years through some integration of GIS and GPS and this system. That's where we're headed. So now we've got the ultimate instrument of monitoring and surveillance. That's a pretty powerful tool if you happen to be, for instance, a dictator. So how do we confront that? How do we create and work to create a technology, which I'll talk about later, we need, but has such a potential for abuse? Well, it turns out that the nation states themselves have already covered this issue, in that the nation states are spying on each other all the time. They do this in order to understand their defense postures and attack postures. And so about 30 years ago, they established something called the Open Skies Policy, which is that it's perfectly legal for us to fire up as many satellites as we want over the former Soviet Union. It was as legal as day for them to fire up over us because it actually preserved the balance of power. It turned out that making this a unilateral relationship was the best way to ensure security. And so overall, the only thing that I can think of is the best way to make this not an instrument of terror, but an instrument of utility, is to give it away. And so when we put this site up, I announced that I'd be putting up all the code, which I hadn't done. I wanted to wait until 2.0 was out. Why did I want to do that? Because I wanted to empower people with making it work. I want to make this model grow. I want to make it more useful. But I'm only a single individual, so I'm confronting something very similar to what Tony and I confronted about 2.5 years ago after we'd done the initial work on VRML. How could we make that grow? How could we make it take root? Well, the answer was very simple. You give it away. You try not to hold on to it. You give it away. It worked for VRML. And because we gave it away, because we opened the doors, because we said, have a seat at the table and help, people did. It took off. We call that the stone soup analogy. And so I am very pleased to announce today the Web Earth Initiative. I've been putting this together for about 6 months, and this is how it's starting to play out. There are three major partners in this initiative. The first one is Digital Equipment Corporation. We will be using the computing power and connectivity of the Network Systems Laboratory. You may be familiar with one of their products. It's called AltaVista. So we will have access to the largest and most competent and most well-connected machines on the internet to develop and transmit visualizations of the planet. So what exactly are we going to start with? What are we going to visualize? Clearly, climatological data. But in fact, one of our other partners is the World Health Organization in Geneva, WHO, and specifically the person of Larry Brilliant, who is the person who put smallpox in a test tube because he methodically went through India in the 1970s and wiped it out. And so our databases that we will start with, the databases we will be visualizing with, will be the epidemiological databases for the planet. Now, all of that is infrastructure. There's databases, there's connectivity. But where's the community? And the community is the key aspect. And I'm also happy to say that Howard Rheingold and the crew at Electric Minds have given me refuge. And starting with Electric Minds launch in about 2 weeks' time, I will be officiating at something we call Vermal University. Because in order to get people working on this model, they have to be trained. They have to learn what VRML is or what visualization techniques are. And so that will be a forum where first we will be teaching them VRML, second we'll be teaching them how to visualize databases, and third we'll be teaching them how to teach others how to do this. Because we need that ground. And in addition, it serves as the connection point for the researchers, for the policymakers, and for the just plain folks who have interest in what's going on in the model. So what will we do? Well, I want to start with climatology. That's climatology right there. We'll move on to epidemiology and then into the environment, because clearly all of these are very closely related. If I could take a look at pollution statistics against epidemiology statistics against climatology statistics, all of a sudden a whole bunch of correlations would be clear to me that for some reason we haven't been able to make clear to our legislators. And when confronted with the pure existence of a fact, it cannot be argued away. I've been saying for some time that I personally believe that cyberspace is the premier environment for planetary management because it allows us to see the whole in relation to its constituent parts. And we cannot, as 2-meter human beings, do that effectively without the construction of some medium. And so the people who are going to be most directly affected by this medium, the scientists and the policymakers, are the first ones we will reach out to. But most importantly, the just plain folks like you and I are the bedrock of this initiative. So now I want to make a desperate plea. I need your help. We need your help. This will not work unless we all get together to do it, because the world cannot be built in a day, and it cannot be built by one person. So you've probably all noticed that, in fact, the Earth that's floating around on your screen is a mirror image. My texture maps are precisely reversed right to left. And this is the last bug. I've been working on this all week. This is the last bug I need to solve, and then it'll be clean. But in the end, I said, no, wait. Brian Eno wouldn't approve anyway. You're supposed to flaunt your bugs. wait, we're seeing this earth in the mirror. And that's exactly what this is all about. This is earth as avatar. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. Our next speaker and final speaker is Brett Leonard, filmmaker, film director of such films as Virtuosity and Lawnmower Man. And it's very interesting because what Brett does, he's ahead of us. He's dictating to the masses what virtual reality and nanotechnology, how they are viewed by the society at large. So I think what Brett has to say is of great importance, and maybe that's the role of a visionary. Brett? Next to last. I'm sorry.
Actually, I'm Brett Leonard, the schmuck from Hollywood who has to follow Mark Pesci at an Avatar conference. so just see me as the sacrificial lamb here. It's kind of ironic that I'm on this panel because basically what I make movies about are what not to do with virtual worlds. And that, I believe, is my primary function as a storyteller in this genre, if you could call it that. And I'm going to continue to do that. And that's going to be something I'm going to be addressing a little bit later. Many of you might be aware of the films I've made. I'm not going to go into those very heavily. What I'm doing lately is I'm the co-chairman of a company called L Squared Communications, and we are launching something called IZTV, the Interactive Sandbox. And some of you might see some of the hats around. There's a question mark inside that because we're saying, what is TV becoming? And why TV? Well, TV because that's what most of the people out there who aren't at this conference basically think about what media is right now. So we have to start somewhere that can address a mass audience perception. And that's primarily where my work is focused, which is means that primarily most of the things I do is not for anyone here. Which always puts me in an interesting position at these things. One of the focuses of the company is how to create something that really launches the idea of the virtual medium as a mass market initiative or as something that truly can address a mass audience as film and television have. And we're in Hollywood. I work in Hollywood. I make films in Hollywood. We're doing that through connecting the dots to the Hollywood talent base. Now, many here probably think that's a bad idea because the Hollywood talent base, they don't know anything about interactivity. They don't know anything about virtual mediums. They know about the passive medium. And that's exactly why I'm starting there. One, that's why I found my initial success, and also I happen to love cinema and always will, no matter what happens with the virtual medium. But two, basically, my feeling is that you have to kind of work as a viral infiltrator. And unless you can get to the people that the mass audience out there that don't surf the net right now, that don't really understand what the virtual meme is about, that they follow, that they model, how are we ever going to basically, you know, activate this into a mass market initiative, into something that people beyond who are using it right now, and I still feel that this is a niche medium, it is a niche market from any kind of mass market perspective. You have to basically inculcate that group of people into something. So what are we inculcating them into? That's the key question. Because I think one of the interesting things to me about this conference is that many people have talked about how important this is, how important the standards are, how important avatars are, how important this whole medium is, and I can't agree more. I believe the stakes are extremely high on what everyone in this room is doing. Possibly as high, if not higher, than what Henry Ford and the people that created the internal combustion engine and the initiatives that created sort of the technological society as we know it for the past 100 years created at the turn of the last century. And I kind of think, what were their conferences like when those guys got together? Okay, were they talking about a lot of the, you know, the nugglies of these different things? I'm sure they were talking about how to make something work faster, how to be more efficient with fuel, all of the same issues. But how many of them are really focusing on and seeing our world today from 100 years ago? I doubt any of them really saw what we're now living in. And obviously we're living in something where that technological society, those breakthroughs have created a serious problem on our planet. And I believe that the stakes are just as high, if not higher, for this technology. And that's why I'm going to continue to make cautionary tales, because I think that that is what has to be out there in the zeitgeist. You have to stir the pot. You have to make those points about what is this about. How are you going to have a group of people that are basically, you know, tuned into their screens through whatever kinds of display technologies, and their entire lives are going on in cyberspace? I mean, I know that is a very generic concern that many have voiced, but I don't think anyone really is still addressing that. How do you create this and connect it to real life? How do you model something and break down the passive audience paradigm that we exist? Because right now we have a passive audience paradigm. That is what exists out there. So if that passive audience paradigm absorbs this technology, what makes us think they're going to use it for anything more than what they're using it for now, which is a kind of sort of masturbation in a sense, both literal and also in a metaphorical sense. And given that, that's why I'm working in the Hollywood community. That's why we're connecting to people that have had success in passive audience. The people that have had success in the passive audience paradigm have gotten to a tremendous group of people, a tremendous number of people. I mean, whether the people here like it or not, The Long Man has been seen by about 1 billion people worldwide at this point. That's what happens when you get into a mass audience paradigm. I happen to make a movie about, it's basically the Frankenstein myth of a guy turning into an avatar. That's what that movie was about. That is one of the first points of contact for a lot of kids worldwide who saw that movie. And I started realizing that dramatic context, just to bring that dialogue out, was an important function. And one of the reasons I got into sort of an entrepreneurial mode with L Square Communications was, how do you follow those kinds of cautionary tales up with something that provides a positive framework? And that really is something that's come home to me more and more, because recently my wife Kelly and I have had a child. He's almost 2 years old. And I'm thinking, what is the media world that Shannon is going to inhabit? What's he really going to be doing? Many of you may know the work of Joseph Chilton Pierce. In his book Evolution's End, he talks about how passive media basically seems to be hardwiring the brains of our children into a less functional model than what, you know, active communication can do. How can we take this medium so that our children have a more active participant model? So what are the tenets behind IsTV? IsTV, basically we're saying, is about empowering people to create. We're using the Hollywood metaphor, which is everybody wants to be a director. Okay, that's the joke in Hollywood. Well, the truth is, everybody does want to be a director. I'm sure everybody in this room thinks they could direct a film better than I. And I'm saying, you're right. And that we have to take that to people with tools that allow them to spontaneously and transparently create as much beauty, as much terror, as much anything that they want, that they can connect themselves to, so that they can see that they are the creators of that, not just the receivers of data, the receivers of entertainment. And so by getting inside of the Hollywood community with that idea, and there are people, by the way, there that, because they're so successful in all the things they've done, they're movie stars, they're moguls, they've done the Hollywood thing, they're looking for the next thing. There are real supporters in that framework there that can really connect into what this group of people are doing in a very deep way. And that's what L Square Communications really is about. We're trying to be a bridge between the language systems, because it's definitely, you know, a queasy communication that takes place between this group of people and the entertainment community at large. I mean, it's sort of a combination to me of NASA and vaudeville, because it finally comes down to how good is the old soft shoe. That is what people are drawn in by. And if you don't have that kind of showmanship, if you don't have a unifying principle that Joe Sixpack can go to and say, that's what the digital lifestyle is about, man. I mean, if you don't have that, then you're going to have some other people defining that. And I'm not going to talk about who those other people are, but I'm sure a lot of you here know that there are some people out there that have, to my mind, some very scary ideas. There was a slide in the keynote that said the battle for people's hearts and minds, or the battle for people's minds. And I believe that is exactly what is going to be taking place over the next few years. We're going to see a system come in place, which is why the standards committee is so important. I wish actually I was down there just to hear what the hell was going on. But what are the things that are going to be inherently imbued into this medium? And how can we get change makers? How can we get people that people look to for modeling to model something that breaks down the passive audience paradigm as opposed to reinforces it? So that's one of the things we're doing. One of the projects we're working on right now is something that we're doing with both CAA, Creative Artist Agency, and Intel. And we are putting a IZTV virtual studio node in the middle of CAA, which is, you know, arguably one of the epicenters of Hollywood. A lot of people that matter to the mass audience worldwide go through those doors. And we're basically creating something in there that, again, the viral infiltration metaphor works very well for me, because there's not any room inside CA that's not square walls. It's a very, very, you know, I am pay square walled kind of cold environment. And this room that we're putting in there, they've spent about $1 million building it, is shaped kind of like an ovum. and it's sitting there in the middle of this thing, completely different shape of the walls, different shape of how people are coming in to interact with the entertainment. Danny DeVito plays an avatar in the content that we're playing. And Danny is someone who's a very interesting person. I mean, here's a movie star, a very unlikely movie star, who also is a mogul, who has a tremendous, you know, effect on the Hollywood community because he gives young people in filmmaking a chance. He really supports new energy in the film business. Well, he'd never really gotten into this digital stuff, as he would like to say, and we took him into a motion capture session. And we put this, you know, 20-pound rig on his head, and for about 13 hours one day, he did all the motion capture for this avatar character. At the end of the day, he is now Digital Dan and will forever be Digital Dan. He is so into this because he saw, you know what, there's a maverick thing going on here with this new medium, with these new tools, and it's something that I can take to the next level. He understands production value. You know, people like myself, I understand how to bring production value to visual production. How to connect those dots with the things that the people in this room are doing is something I'm very, very interested in, because until we go past a certain level of production value, a certain level of the soft shoe, so to speak, we're never going to draw in enough people to make this a mass market. And that's what we have to do. We have to connect the dots to the people that are currently doing that in the world, and those that are really pioneering what is truly a new medium. That being said, one of the things that I think is important in the context of this whole thing, and I personally feel that chat is something that it doesn't really empower me to do much. It's chaotic. It's like going in the middle of a busy street and screaming. And, I mean, that's just my experience with it. So in looking at that, what is it that people can draw in? First speaker had talked about the fact that this is very similar to theater, that the core competencies around designing these worlds really have a lot to do with improvisational theater, and I cannot agree more. One of the people I've talked with about this is Jeff Goldblum, who I made a film with, Hideaway, and he happens to be the head of the Playhouse West. He's one of the primary teachers of the Meisner Method there. And the Meisner Method is really a tremendous sort of framework for doing interactive drama. And if you look at the core competency, people, you know, in Hollywood community learn in the Meisner Method, they never use that in their television and film work. They do that basically as a way of getting to that point of doing something that's more in a passive medium. Well, one of the things we're trying to do is connect into those core competencies and bring them into the creation of interactive drama and virtual worlds. That's what we're doing on the people side of things. On the code side of things, we have a young man named Georg Gerber who is writing something called IDDL, Interactive Distributed Drama Language, which is an AI language which basically allows the user of one of these interactive drama worlds to go in and basically become the director. You can transparently direct your own character and other characters in a multi-user environment. And it really is to take that Hollywood metaphor as far as possible, meaning you can be on the set and you can be the one making the decisions. That is, you know, obviously a very, again, generic idea, but if you break that all the way through, you finally get to something where people are living a lifestyle that is truly creating. I mean, I feel very blessed to do what I do. When I go on a set and direct a movie, I mean, I'm a very empowered person. I mean, I go like that and 50 people walk over there. You know, that idea is something that, and then go over there and do something that hopefully, you know, looks good or has some emotion to it. If you can connect people to that idea through a virtual world, if that's what virtual worlds can be about, empowering people to create, because I think that is a primal human need, then we have something that I think that's positive. And I really believe it's a race against time. I mean, when I look at Mark's work with Web Earth, I think that is an amazing piece of work, because to be able to look at the climatology and epidemiology and all those things that are going on and view and visualize the planet that way, that is a positive thing that can be used as a tool, as a sledgehammer in legislature, as a sledgehammer somewhere, using that information as opposed to something that's just screaming in the middle of a street. So that to me is the hope. But at the same time, I want to tell you, this stuff scares the living shit out of me, because I don't know what we're not seeing. There's a horizon factor here. All of us are so incredibly passionate about making this thing work. And all I can say is I'm going to continue to make films and do things that probably piss a lot of people here off, because it's about making sure that those elements are still in the dialogue. Because if we rush headlong to create this stuff, and I really believe the technology is going to move probably more rapidly than anyone believes, and that's obviously counter to what some people believe. I mean, they think, oh, it's going to be slow for a long time. I really think that there are some things going on out there that I'm privy to that are going to basically, you know, take this past the, you know, the shoulder of the exponential curve, and that at that moment we make a choice. We make a choice who's going to control this. And by randomizing it, by getting it out there and connecting it to the passive paradigm and making sure that those people that are doing that are also randomized inside this virtual medium, then we have a chance to do something that isn't controllable by one corporate interest. And that's basically what I'm trying to do with L Squared Communications. Because at the bottom, at the end of the line, that corporation probably will be dissolved. Because anything that in business we are trying to go and control in order to make a profit eventually will become its own enemy, especially to this kind of philosophy. So you have to look at these things, I think, along the lines that Mark is looking, give it away. Give away the empowerment as fast as we possibly can. Thank you.
So I misspoke earlier. Brett was not our final speaker. My apologies. Steve DiPaolo from OnLive Technologies here. He's our final speaker. And then I would encourage people to stick around for a question and answer session. I'm sure it's going to be pretty interesting. Steve, and I'll get the lights.
I'm going to try to keep working this computer because I'm going to get online and talk to some people. This is a product called OnLive Traveler. And I agree with the previous speaker that if all we're doing is extending chat, then what are we really doing? This product is often termed 3D voice chat. And I don't think of it that way. I think of it as a means to do group communications. And there's a big difference between the two of them. So let me kind of quickly whiz through it so we get a little bit of a feel for it, and then we can kind of maybe go up to some people and then talk for a sec. So here we are in this Aztec world that I can move through. I am an avatar, and there are many other head-based avatars here. Now, this system is based on a voice technology that's not peer-to-peer. It's many people speaking to many people at the same time. And that's the basis of the system. It's not about two people speaking. It's about many people getting together. And so that puts it in more of a collaborative framework. So you can hear some voices just in the distance, kind of looking for them. It has distance attenuation. Let's assume these two people up here are talking. I'm going to go over to them.
You're Vixen? Is that your name on here? That's your friend's name.
What? I couldn't understand you.
So the alligator could not hear. So I'm going to drop over. They can't hear
My
it yet.
Name is Ian.
Oh, I see. Someone had come up behind you. Oh, there they are.
Hi, that's me. That's Steve. How you guys doing? So I have to hold the space bar to talk to people.
Fine.
Real good, thank you.
So someone's having some problems.
Ian, you stay a good kid, okay? It'll pay off.
So
I will.
Hey, Ian. This is Steve. How old
Yeah?
are you? Hi, can you see me?
I am 14. Where are you? I can't understand you.
Hi, can you see me now?
Yes, I can see you fine.
How long have you been using this? So I'm on a 28A motor.
This is my first time. I'm talking to you from my friend's house.
Okay, so this is the first time. So she did something a little unusual, which is not turn to look at me. So she's still getting used to the controls. As you can see, this cat here.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Okay.
Is there a way we can understand each other better?
Mm-hmm. Hey, you know, it's not just me in this head. Actually, there's about 200 people in this head.
That's a lot. How many can this system handle?
So what's going on here? As I move away... Oh, okay, what am I? Hey, could you do me a favor? I just want to show people how the distance attenuation works. Can you just start counting? And just keep counting. I'm going to move away and then come back again. So she's kind of
bewildered.
I don't know if I could do this, she says. So there's some bewilderment. I mean, this is like voice chat. She's like, who the hell are you, and why are you bothering me to do these things?
Is that good?
Actually, if you could just keep counting a little bit longer. Okay. Actually, could you count out loud? That's what I mean.
One.
She was just rocking
two,
back and forth,
three,
getting a little nervous.
4, 5, 6, 7.
So now we have a group of people here.
9.
And I went out
10.
To someone at random. I always prefer to do that. Usually they're not a 14-year-old who just used the system for the first time, but whatever works. So what this is about, you know, is about this group communication here, that everyone's here. Now, I'm going to pull back, and she's going to wonder why I don't return, but hopefully some of the other people there are going to talk to her. You can go from space to space here. You can go up to people. I am constrained to this view. I cannot leave my body. Just quickly, that's what I look like. I have some emotions. That's my happy and my miserable. And I could pick different characters, and there's my surprise.
Are you giving that child a hard time?
Okay. Well, we're getting into issues very quickly here, I think. Do you mean the alligator?
Yes.
I'm sorry, yeah, I kind of was using her for a demo without her knowledge. I probably should have got a consent form. So let's just...
No. I didn't know if you ever.
So,
Hey, how's it going?
So this is often a problem, and I think will continue to be a problem. I right now am confronted in a physical, virtual dilemma here. I have physical people who I'm supposed to talk to, who in fact paid money, but I am here as well, and I have to deal with that. And actually, that's a lot of what this software is about, and a lot of what we're trying to do with avatars and the whole conference in general is that it's binding the pair. That I am at my computer, but this person called Steve, who actually has a Jesus avatar, is here. And how do I deal with that? And all this software is specifically about trying to combine those two. So you can't leave your head. You have all these natural emulation processes happening, like 3D sound, so I can hear something more to one side than the other.
Hey, Steve.
Hey, how you doing? And again, this is
pretty
not
good. Where you at?
This is really not about chat stuff. It's not like it's rare that I walk into a conversation and everyone's talking about one subject, like a chat metaphor. This isn't really like that. This is group communication. In fact,
Steve, where are you hailing from?
Hey, I'm up in San Francisco right now.
Say that again.
I'm in San Francisco right now. So it's a lot of hanging around, moving around, because, again, it's not like chat. It's
I
about
still couldn't get that.
Yeah, I'm going to pull back. I've been watching this while everybody has been speaking. People keep coming up to me with the sound off, trying to get me to talk. So there's a number of people here talking. And, again, I want to pull away. We have a booth if you want to see it. And there's a later conversation that it's not my talk really isn't about this product per se. It's about, you know, what's up with worlds? Why do we want to do it this way? So I'm claiming it's about collaboration. It's about group communication. It's about that when people get together and do a music jam, and some magic happens, and we want to get that magic to happen here. So, well, can you do that with teleconferencing, with video conferencing? You know, my take is, because of the telepresence that we have here, the immersiveness, that you're really there, at least you feel that you're really there, something completely different happens. And it has a lot more to do with kind of hanging out. You know, what people used to hang out in their porch, and people used to come by, and if there was a conversation lack, the conversation lagged a little bit, it was okay because there was gazing going on. There's a lot of messages being passed back and forth. As you can tell, when someone came up to me and said, are you bothering that person? I mean, did they get that all from my speech or that I kind of walked away, you know? And I mean, I did antisocial behavior. It wasn't all because of what I said. So it's really about that. And I don't think that really works with even the biggest of video conferencing walls, because there still is a definite separation. Again, I don't want to think that Tony's online, that Tony is really in Chicago, and he's got a mic in the space, and I got a mic in the space, and our mics are talking to each other. But in fact, that both of us have come here. And one of the things that people ask a lot is, this is great, I got to get my family here. You know, oh, I got to get a Pentium because I want my family. Well, they could talk to their family on the phone. But this is something different. This is bringing people together. And it's passing kind of the unsaid and some of the understanding that kind of goes back and forth. It's something that computers are notoriously awful about. You know, they're all about what's the context, what's happening, you know, give me data. But now it's all right to, like, not be giving data, just to be kind of feeling the mood of other people. It kind of gets back that, you know, we were all in a tribe at one point, and that kind of hanging around, not really talking, maybe telling a story here or there, and kind of gazing at people was something that was important. So that's quite different than a peer-to-peer situation. And again, what can you do in a world? Well, one thing we can do, obviously, is some distance learning. But again, very different from a one-to-one, or like you see on the cable channel, kind of a one-to-many. The kind of distance learning we'd like to do when we're trying to work out is where classes all get on one system. So there would be a teacher maybe running the computer with a big monitor, the whole class is there, and they go to a fair, what's called an international fair, where you learn about people, classrooms from other places. So it's 6-year-olds, it's 10-year-olds getting on a system and asking very simple questions to their peers in Japan, in China, in England. But the difference is it's serendipitous, because you walk up to people and you kind of go, that's a great one. You know, the guy from England said something different. Let's go over there. And it's that why it turns a standard distance learning into something more like kind of this affair or group collaboration. That's kind of what it's about. We're also doing tonight at the party, there's going to be a voci, and we did this at Sigrat, people who were there, which is a group chant session. So we basically have a boom mic where everyone can get around it, become one avatar, and do some Tibetan chanting with people from different cities. And it's pretty interesting. There's some delay that happens here, because we're over the internet. Again, this is, I think I got 24-4 out of this building on a telephone right line here on my 133 Pentium. So it's all quite simple stuff, but there is delays and things, but it works very well with actually some of the breathing exercises they do with Voci. That's another example of what you can kind of do today. This is a community here, and I'm going to bring up Where Are People. And it's going to tell me, can people read that all the way in the back? Not really, right? Okay, so it's basically just saying who's in what room and how many people are there. And I can go to different rooms based on that. Now, these people are all in something called Utopia, which is one community. But I'm going to go to a different community. We did a community for MTV. I will go there. So we have something that seems like a travel metaphor here, although this is very simple art at the moment, to kind of imply that you're going somewhere. And when you get there, you actually fall into the space, and people can see you falling into the space. So you don't just pop in front of people. We want to keep some kind of metaphor alive, that you really are coming and going, rather than just popping in and out. And that's the basis of this particular software, which is what's the natural way, the natural social paradigm, you know?
Excuse me. Actually, while we're traveling, Bruce just poked his head in to say that lunch is on now. So if anybody wants to slip out, that's fine.
And now we're hearing the environment, so we're just about there. So we're coming in from the top. You can see there's some people here. Somebody named Johnny. And I can go up to Johnny and speak to him. And there's pretty much no UI here, right? I just move and talk. I'm in this kind of push-to-talk mode, so I hit the space bar when I want to talk. Johnny, let's see if Johnny's ready. I'm going to assume that Johnny isn't there. Some people come in without a microphone.
Hello, how are you?
Oh, actually, Johnny said hello to me. I think. Let me go over to this guy. Hi, how are you doing? This is Steve. So one thing that's quite interesting that happens is if somebody gets too close to someone, they push back. In fact, when people come too close to me, I get a funny feeling in my stomach. And that's kind of what we're after. Johnny's a dog.
Hello, how are you?
Good. Where are you traveling in from?
I'm coming from Sweden.
Sweden. You sound very good in Sweden.
Sorry?
So you just went back, which I just said to him, notice how I went too close to him and he pulled back a little bit. Because it's actually, the whole idea is that this is real. When you get it to be real, then these great group dynamics happen. When there's a bunch of people, there's about six or seven people who form a circle. And other people try and make their way in, but it never seems to be much more than six to seven, because it's exactly what happens in real life, because there's enough cues here for that to happen. She doesn't want to talk to me anymore because I said something stupid. And in fact, that's the problem. I can go up to a bunch of people, and I have to worry that I might say something stupid and they won't even turn to me. And then I got to walk away dejected. So this is the idea of kind of a more group communication thing, where people really get together and form, and there's more of a nucleus going on, and it brings a whole level above a standard chat situation. Everybody's hungry. This is, you can see this particular demo all throughout. So I encourage people to get on and download it, and I'll talk to you online. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Steve.
Hi, Steve. Can you hear me anywhere?
So now is a good chance for some people who want to sort of zip out to, you know, we'll take a moment, people can kind of clear if they want. And I would ask the speakers, if they're game to miss some of the lunchtime, to stick around. We'll take a few questions. Okay, guys, I think we've got sort of the hardcore folks remaining here. If people could just sort of come to order, maybe we'll take a couple questions from the crowd. Anybody out there? Yeah, in the front row. Can we have some quiet here, please? Thanks.
So Vermal University will be offered as part of Electric Minds. It'll be completely free. It should be at least 24 weeks of course, probably more like 10,000 weeks of course, because I haven't figured out quite where to stop yet. And it'll be at www.minds.com. All right, if you go there right now, I think they have just some promo information about the site up, but it's going live in a few weeks.
Thanks. Other questions? Yeah. Okay, if I could just paraphrase the question. The question was basically, and you know, slam me if I'm wrong here. The question was basically, most of the discussions that this participant has engaged in virtual spaces and chat spaces in general tend to be pretty much soundbite oriented, fairly shallow, and largely logistic. I would say kind of like the early days of ham radio. You know, calling Tokyo, are you there? Hello? Yeah, loud and clear, I'm on this band. So that's one that actually lots of folks on the panel might be interested in addressing. Since you have the mic, Mark, you want to just
take a very short crack at it
because we're running late.
Social context is actually the thing that can be the greatest determinant of a discussion. For instance, at MediaMoo, they have the Tuesday Night Cafe where people will all tell it in for a text chat in a MOOB, but there's a theme, there's a regular group of people, and so these are not just normal chats. The problem, I think, with chat is shouting in the street is because you don't know anyone in the street.
As I mentioned, unique and persistent identity are key things we need to look forward at as we go forward. I was a real quick story. In Worlds Away, I was approached by a consortium to do what would be the at the end of Club Caribe's life to do a new version for the PC and the Macintosh. Of course, consortium had put together hundreds of thousands of dollars. Now, it wasn't enough, but this all occurred with people I'd never met. MediaMoo is a wonderful example of a community I've been in for a long time. IRC provides no context because it provides none of the cues you need. It's really important when providing context to allow people to do things like make assertions about their reputations. Mark's talk about the dossiers in the hospital works both ways. I mean, he's right, you lose some of your reality in favor of the dossier, but the dossier is a powerful tool for establishing context for conversation. Without it, you have nothing. It's being treated at a hospital with no dossier is completely different than if they know a lot about you. So reputation systems and persistent identity as a are important features that are currently missing from, like, if the Vermals and also on live. And it really changes everything. For 15 years, we've been building communities of people who travel to be together and do real things together and form real groups. People have done dissertations online in MOOCs with the community. So there's real work going on. It, again, context and persistence matter.
Yeah, I think one of the key things just in what I'm playing with is how to bring the tenets of theater, which really are the tenets of structure and guidance, to these kinds of virtual worlds. And actually, although I agree that it doesn't have a lot to do with film, there still are cinematic techniques that can be utilized to point the way. I mean, this is a visual medium on a screen. So the rhetoric of cinema actually really does connect to this medium, as long as you don't step over the issue of allowing it to be free enough for there to be true participant interaction. And where that balance point is something that I'm playing with very much to try to, you know, take someone and really guide them in a way that doesn't step on their own free expression, but still allows there to be a dramatic context to the whole thing, and there to be that inherent production value of montage and that idea. If you go back to, you know, when film first came to be, just it was basically like, you know, shooting a proscenium arch stage play, and then, you know, Sergei Eisenstein said, gee, we could, like, cut to a close-up here. And that was a very, very strange idea, if you think about it. Why do people accept that? Why do people, you're looking at this audience here, and suddenly I'm close on your face, and we watch a film, and we don't have any problem with that at all. I think the same tenets of sort of perceptual persistence like that apply to this medium, and really hasn't been begun to be played with yet. And that's what's most exciting to me.
I would argue also that avatar appearance is important. I mean, it may not be as important as, you know, in-depth information, a profile, a persistent information, but that appearance is the first set of cues that you get, and that's vital to initiating any kind of social contact.
Let me pass this to Steve.
We're addressing this issue a lot right now in On Live. The space you just saw, which was pretty much an Aztec plaza, you know, we got all the infrastructure to get it going and got people in there and gee whiz and this fun. And what we realized is what we had was, in fact, a nice plaza in a country that you've never been to before with strangers in it. So, yeah, that's exactly what happens there. So what's needed is all the social engineering that goes along with it. Obviously, having events so people have affinity groups and they go places, but also different kinds of communication. What we want to do is turn it from a plaza in a foreign country to turn it to your community. So you need a post office, and you need a newspaper, and you need you need the police. You need a number of things, of which, because we're basically technologists with some funky ideas, we do the technology first, and we're getting blown away by all the social engineering that needs to be done. And the last three hires at On Live were all social engineers trying to deal with this issue. So it's a big one.
Actually, I've been tapped on the shoulder and informed that the next session needs to set up. So I want to thank you guys for sticking around. I want to thank the panelists, and we'll see you around.